Sergey.
Hey, Tim.
Some people think quantum computing is hard.
Yeah, of course, man. I mean, it's physics. And even worse, man, it's quantum physics.
But Sergey, if we don't understand or use quantum physics, we can't build quantum computers. If we can't build quantum computers, there's like a heap of hard problems that we'll never solve. Yeah? But we want to, we need to. And it will be really, really hard to do it without. It's a little bit like telling Margaret Hamilton, the software engineer for the Apollo moon lander, to do her coding job without the digital computer. So how are we going to do this?
Hey man, relax. Oh. I mean, we're switching too fast, yeah. But relax, we'll get there, and we'll in the future pioneer this weird field that you just talking about.
It's called Hilbert space.
Yeah.
So, my name is Tim Leonhardt.
And I'm Sergey Bespalov.
And in a universe far, far away, in a time long, long ago, we were on the way to the fields of purity and science and brightness.
But we joined the dark forces. Because we left the fields of purity, right? And now we're doing distributed ledger technology, artificial intelligence, and for some reason it doesn't switch now. Yeah, extended reality and quantum computing.
So,
let's start with the fundamentals, Tim.
Exactly. Let's start with the fundamentals. Always love to talk about that. And we go one further. So, what is quantum computing about? Yeah, typically we have to start with physics. And I'll try to be quick. There are essentially new laws you have to learn, and that you can always also use as a tool to use with new computers. So what are these new strange rules? One is superposition. And you remember the coin toss? Yeah. Typically, the outcome is one or zero. In quantum computing, it's a little bit like the coin is turning the whole time, and you can change the admixture of head and tails gradually as you like. So it's a little bit of parallelism, but it's also not. The other thing is tunnel effect. Imagine that typically you have a barrier that you're running into and you can't cross. Now, with quantum computing, you have some strange effects that you throw a squash ball against this wall very, very hard and very often, and suddenly it morphs just through, and you're on the outside in a new territory that you can explore. And the last one, that one even Einstein found a little bit confusing because it's called entanglement. So imagine you have two of the dice that you just saw, presented before, and you play against your friend and you want to have doubles always. Funny thing is, you won't get it. We all know you can't really change that. With quantum physics, actually, you can entangle them, and every time you throw them, you don't know which doubles you get, but it will be 100% sure that it's doubles. And the funny thing is, you can do this on the different sides of the universe, and you always get the same result. Hmm. So there we go.
Yeah, Tim, but what are you talking about here, actually? I mean,
quantum physics, of course.
Ah, I got it. This is the thing where you just kind of, you guys take a cat and then put it in a box.
Wait, no cats hurt, no boxes involved. It's just a thought experiment.
Of course. You guys, theoretical quantum physicists, you just do thought experiments. You never produce something, real that we can actually
use. Not. We have a new application.
So you finally built the box and put a cat in it?
No, we built a box and put a computer in it, a quantum one. That's how it looks like. Yeah, of course, not output this. This is on the IBM system. And the interesting thing is that every one of you here in the room, you can open your mobile and you can access this thing. Yeah, so it's really available to everyone on a small scale. And there are a lot of startups building these and bigger corporates that start to scale up this technology. And I, as a physicist, I love it because it's a technology push, a new technology that might change something in the society in the future.
But wait, Tim. Isn't it this typical hammer and you're looking for a nail problem, right? So, I mean, where is the real life application, right? We need some real life application because only this creates innovation by so-called market pool, right?
So, where's your market pool?
Well, okay, let me show you. Back in the days, I will try to tell you a story about two chemists. By the way, where's the guy? Two-man chemists, Karl Bosch and Fritz Haber. They developed this Haber-Bosch process to basically take ammonia from air, create not ammonia. They created ammonia, basically. Yeah, they took nitrogen. Created ammonia and produced fertilizer to feed the world.
What?
Groundbreaking.
How you do it?
Well, simple. So basically, we take the natural gas, all right, remove sulfur from it, then put water in the primary reformer, and then we heat it up slightly.
Slightly? You mean like the room temperature? So like the bacteria do this, they accept the same thing at room temperature?
Well, not quite. Couple degrees, 100 degrees. 100.
Seems like you're joining the dark forces.
Eh? Yeah, man. We use about 2% of the world energy produced only for this one. Man, this is super cool, but it's not that environmental friendly, right? So basically, we have a problem, and I would like to join the good forces again. But we have a problem, right? And I would like to show you where the problem is. So basically, we would like to understand how the nature does this. But in order to understand this, we need to simulate many things, right? And we need some approaches to do that. So basically, on one hand, we have this kind of a molecular mechanics approach where we treat the molecules as a classical physical objects with the balls and
cool, easy, you know?
Yeah, but unfortunately, I mean, we don't get the accuracy we need, and basically we can just simulate the geometry optimization, but we need to simulate like interactions between the molecules, and we need to simulate their polarity and everything, but for that, we need to go to the quantum mechanics, right? Another approach is do it semi-empirical, where we just measure a couple of things in the lab, put it in the computer, then calculate, and
works good?
Not quite. The problem with that is, this is already like 100 times slower than that one, and you see how long it takes, right? And it's not accurate enough, right? So what we would like to do is like we do this ab initio method, means from the beginning, we would like to take the equation from that evil guy with the cat.
Yeah. No.
Okay, sorry, not the evil guy, good guy, yeah. And to calculate this, but for huge molecules, it seems to be an untractable problem because it will take too long to do this. It's not possible. Can you help me?
I think so. There are a couple of very good ideas. Yeah? Even Richard Feynman, I think almost 30 years ago, said nature isn't classical. If you want to simulate nature, make it quantum. So that's what we are trying with quantum computers. Yeah? You see, you just start from the classical world. It's a little bit like the assembler code. Yeah? You have a couple of bits. This is qubits on the left side. You start with them, you do all these nice operations and move through the barriers, move the waves in a way that is right. It's a little bit hard. But at the end, you have like one solution and one blob that pops up that you can measure. You know? So that could work.
Well, this sounds awesome, Tim. But do you think there are some like areas, maybe other areas also than chemistry that the quantum computers might help us?
Yeah, there are a couple of theorists who really thought about newer ideas how to improve machine learning. They have very specific problems that they're speeding up. There's the simulation idea of not only simulating molecules, but maybe financial systems. There's optimization problems of how you do scheduling for instance, for this room at RWTH, very hard, I heard. And there's the security problem. Yeah, we have Shor's algorithm. And it's in 10 years, roughly, it will really be an issue that quantum computers might crack our communication and make data insecure, so that's relevant.
This sounds exciting, man. But come on, I heard this whole thing isn't practical. I mean, it's not working.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's where we have kind of a problem. Yeah? So if you ask Google how the protocol type is coming along, it tells you this. So quantum computers are somehow in a superposition of being very successful and at the same time not working at all.
Can I check that?
That's a tricky question. But maybe I can tell you how it's going on. Yeah? So actually, what are we doing to check if quantum computers are faster? The original algorithms of Shor are like, if you look at them, how many qubits you need and then how many operations you have to do, it's just feasible. They didn't take into account that these machines that IFA experimentalists had to build are small and erroneous. So they're trying something else. And maybe you know this Galton board. Yeah, they will throw a ball on top and then goes left or right at the pits. And what comes out is this really nice bell shape that even the chemists and mathematicians love because it pops up everywhere. Some of these distributions are really hard to produce, but you need them for all kinds of calculations. So what we can do with a quantum computer is we can take the samples, or throw the balls, very, very quickly. And the interesting thing is that Google and Xanadu have built machines that do this on microsecond scale, and supercomputers take years to do this job. Yeah? So we have quantum advantage, but...
Yeah, listen, this sounds interesting, and I mean, this explains some theoretical, abstract algorithms solving something, but are there some like real-life applications, right?
Yeah, and that's where we're getting back to your nitrogen fixation. Yeah, I mean, physicists have heard that this is a hard problem, and about like 5 years ago, they started published papers on this. So they really calculated how many qubits do I need, what kind of gate operations do I need to do, and they came out with great numbers. You only need 1 million to 100 million qubits. Bummer. But it went on, yeah, and they did new results. They involved all this stuff that already existed, like this UCC, SD, something. So they're actually, they reduced the number of qubits and they're really developing the results fast. And the interesting thing is they even run this on real quantum computers. It's not all theory. You really do your nitrogen and some diamond calculations on a real quantum computer and it works. It's not faster than a supercomputer, but we're getting there.
But Tim, listen, I mean, all good, but those guys are all cracks, you know? And I mean, they're specialized in their field and nobody understands them, but can we get with those scientific cracks?
Yeah, I mean, so on one hand, yeah, look at the paper, it's from 2017, yeah? So if you are like studying math or physics, yeah, you can catch up in a couple of years just doing the task, reading the papers, and you can try it. And for everyone else here in the room, I mean, some of the most interesting innovations for applications that really changed our life, out-of-the-box thinking.
Please leave the cats alone, huh?
Yes.
Okay.
Never heard. Some of this didn't happen at universities.
No, this
so
sounds
give it
good.
A try.
Yeah, I mean, this sounds good, but can you tell me how can I join the team to develop the future of quantum computing and to become a quantum data scientist?
And you don't have to go into garage also, yeah? Just take your cell phones out. And there are many possibilities. Yeah? There are a couple of papers on how industry might use this, how these use cases are kind of screened.
Yes. By the way, I asked this for a friend of mine, not for me.
Okay? Yeah, okay. Just, yeah.
Just so we're clear.
At our employer. you can read these magazines, you can go to a Qiskit textbook, yeah, that introduces these gates. But if you really want to make something fun with it, and that's why we are here, you can do art, you can build Lego quantum computers, there are people building games on this stuff. Yeah? So really think about what can you do with it. And there are many courses, yeah, if you want to go deeper into the physics, feel free to join. We need people to work on this, it will be our generation that shapes how it looks like.
So we really hope that you now share the joy that we have with working with quantum computers, and
we really do hope if you take one message away from this.
As a good friend of ours, Obi-Wan Kenobi, said, don't ask quantum mechanics what it can do for you, ask what you can do with quantum mechanics.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Maybe one more message before you continue. Another great thing to do is to join the team of TEDxRWTH Aachen. I was part of it 10 years ago, and there's nothing better to see what it has become. And you can be the person who shapes it for the next 10 years.